Everybody, if we can start to gather, I think we're getting ready to get going. So if we could come around, that'd be great. Thank you. Getting ready to get underway so we can gather in front of Lawton Hall. That would be helpful. Thank you.
Got some sound. Here we go. Okay.
Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled
Alexandra Miskovich for singing for us this morning, and thank you so much to the American Legion Color Guard. Welcome to the 10th annual Ride for Heroes. How's everyone doing?
Parade!
We're going to get started today. It's, like I said, the 10th year, and I want to introduce a couple people that started this annual tradition. Back 10 years ago, they came to us and said, hey, they had this idea, we've been doing it ever since. So I'm going to start off with, well, we have Colin Young and Terry Emond, and here is Terry.
Thank you for coming. I just want to point out that it's the Ride for Heroes, and the heroes that we're riding for are all those first responders, and especially the ones that seek help here. So thank you all for coming to support those heroes.
Rob Simpson, 10 years ago, approached me about starting this bike ride and getting this going for the program. With Terry, there was a friend of mine that could have used this program about a year, year and a half before this happened. And I busted my butt trying to do this and everybody else. And he's been my drive all these years. And I just want to say that him and his family say thank you. He used the program this year and it saved his life. And I want to say thank you to everybody for helping with that.
We've had so much support for this event, and I just want to thank personally all of our sponsors that this couldn't be possible. Our platinum sponsors this year, Mark Richards from the Richards Group has been a tremendous help since the very beginning. I want to thank Rick Krolik at Sodexo and his whole team that are over there providing us with breakfast and lunch and everything. And of course, Peter Case over to my left, to your right, from the Peak Radio that has also been supportive since the very beginning. Our gold sponsors this year are American Infidels Veterans Motorcycle Club, Brattleboro Pharmacy, David Manning, GS Precision, Health Plans Inc., Ken Becker, Life Cycle Renewables, Monadnock Harley Davidson, Dr. Drew Pate and Dr. Tess Carpenter, Stop and Go Instant Oil Change, SimQuest, and Wayside Fences. Please, when you see those people, thank them for their support. There's also, we have a lot more silver and bronze sponsors as well. You'll see on your t-shirts and some of the other materials. Please join me in thanking all these sponsors. So today we have a very special guest who would like to tell us about her experience with the Uniformed Service Program. It's my pleasure to introduce Karen Haig.
I come from corrections, where I was a senior probation and parole officer specializing in the supervision of sex offenders. And I excelled in this area and became respected for my work because I was good at it until it took its toll. I worked intensely with the offenders, survivors, their families, which included daily discussions with them about their offenses and often seeing images that civilians don't. And in the end, I was completely unable to function. It had taken over my life. So I had to stop doing what I was good at. I had to stop being of service to the community. Handing in my badge was one of the most painful things I've ever done in my life. When I found my way to the Uniformed Service Program, I was on my last leg, and quite honestly, the program saved my life. The amazing staff taught me various skills, all about PTSD, how that actually changed my brain. It also provided me a safe space where I could be vulnerable, which was important because I was always taught to be infallible. When I was in the program, I sat with firefighters, and while on the surface, our jobs could not have been any more different. Underneath, we shared the same reality of serious consequences that would happen if something went wrong on our jobs. I still carry with me the skills that I learned in the program to this very day, and I use them daily. I just use them back behind the porta potties trying to breathe to be up here. Worked out well, I'm standing. I use mindfulness, I use breathing techniques, movement-based meditations, and even fishing, which, as a former city girl, never thought that would happen. And I've also gotten better at identifying and moving towards my values. And my values are my integrity. And the ultimate goal is not just about getting better, it's actually about getting better at being. Some days have been quite challenging. I needed to go back into the program after my original stay, but I was able to do so without stigma based on the staff's compassion and understanding. I also benefit from the alumni program, which allows past participants to stay in touch, engage in activities together, and continue to provide support to one another. I'm returning to school, and this is going to allow me to re-enter the workforce so that I can once again provide service to others in need. I'm the living proof that this program works. You being here today supporting the Uniformed Service Program means that other Uniformed Service professionals will continue to have a place to come and receive help. Thank you. Thank you for supporting us in the professions we do in service of you, as you do us a great service. Thank you.
And now, the blessing of the ride from Father Justin Baker from St. Michael's Roman Catholic Church here in Brattleboro.
I just want to reiterate thanks for doing this, because I see down at the church people come to visit me. I come up here and visit different people that are in the uniform service program, and I've seen a lot of great success out of here. And thank you for all your ride today. Have a good and safe one. Heavenly Father, I ask you to come upon these riders that are offering their time and their talents this morning, but they have a safe ride and raise lots of money for helping the uniform service program. May you send your blessing upon them, and the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But I need you to get a little closer to get the holy water on you, because I guarantee you get it now, you won't get it later. It's not going to rain, okay? Come on, closer.
He really doesn't bite.
I do have my car in front of me. You see that, guys, right?
In order, but I heard that.
Right. Thank you, Father Justin Baker. So we're almost ready to go, and of course, when the ride is done, we'll be back here. We look forward to seeing everybody and having a great barbecue lunch, doing raffles and prizes. First, right before we go, we're going to have, I'm going to hand the mic over to former Marine, retired state trooper, and Harley rider, Mark Hines, to give us the safety speech. And then you'll be on your way. Have a great ride, everybody.
This again is the 10th year we've run this ride. First, I'd like to say welcome home to all you Vietnam vets. And to the other vets, thank you for your service. Today, we've got a nice ride planned down through into Brattleboro, up High Street to Wilmington, north on 100. And just to make it nice, they've scarified several miles of Route 100. Freshly got it done for you. And then on to Route 30 and back here for food. So there's only a couple signals that you really use. If there's something on the side of the road, point to it, and then single file. And then once you've got beyond, back double file. The other thing is if it's pothole, or God knows what you find that scarified. You know, point, if it's on the left side, raise out your foot on the right side so the people behind you can see it, and make sure you pass those signals along so that the guy that's not paying attention 3 bikes back isn't going to run through that pothole at 6 feet deep. Now, the other biggest thing we have is spacing. We use the 2-second rule. Bike in front of you passes a landmark, 1-1000, 2-1000, you should be passing that as well. And the spacing is very important in the first part of this ride, going through downtown and going out Weston Avenue, because you got a lot of traffic out there on a Saturday, and those idiots will try and get into the middle of them. Like, oh, I didn't see you. The sheriff's department is going to lead it. They promise they will keep it slightly below the speed limit and give you time to get around the choke points before they speed back up again. Be careful, because the guy leading it is a former race car driver. Sometimes he thinks he's in a race car again. But anyways, we will have a great ride. John, where are you? Have you found a ride yet? Jim here, comes every year. He doesn't have a bike, but he would need somebody to ride with him. You prefer a trike?
Two wheels,
okay. So if somebody's eligible to give him a ride, just check on him. He's got his own helmet. And in the back, Jim. Okay, thank you. Again, spacing is critical, getting up through and over to Wilmington, and then again up through Dover, because they have a lot of concerts and they'll have a lot of traffic going on. So other than that, enjoy yourselves and have a great day. Yeah. Just for the order of ride, Red Knights are going to be out in front. They will doing some roadblocks where needed. Behind them is the American Infidels, veterans group. They're big into the helping out here. And Monadnock, apparently owns the group, will take up the tail end. We have a wrecker at the back end. We'll have another sheriff's car back there. So if there's a breakdown, just pull to the side. The wrecker will stop and get you and bring you home. Okay?
Thank you, Mark. You can get down and get your bikes.
Honor guard, attention! Right. Right shoulder, arms. Forward, march. Left, 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 right, left.
Thank you. stop along the way?
I don't know if they usually stop at the top of Hogback.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Get some pictures, yeah. Of course.
But one year they went and my friends were over there and they were at the end. They said, we were just pulling in and everybody else was pulling away.
Oh, no kidding. Yeah. Wow.
Cigarette break.
Yeah.
Beer break.
Mike, wow. Come on, guys, proudly, but.
Yeah. Radio guy had it?
Yeah, where the hell did he go?
Well, there's got to be a microphone set up, right? Somewhere?
And then third sight, or third thought, is when you have intuition, right? It's important to know that, like when you're having some sort of like an intuition come up. So it's important to know what, if you're having first thoughts, second thoughts, or third thoughts, right? Is it happening? Is it like in front of your face? Or is it something you're worried about or thinking about? Or is it like that came out of nowhere, right? She's perfect at first sight. She sees exactly what's going on. She sees your pores right now. Every single person here, she's looking. That's the kind of detail that she can see in. It's kind of incredible, right? So she stays right in the moment, doesn't get stuck in the thoughts about the thoughts about the thoughts, right, which is kind of cool. You'll see hawks, usually they're all over the place around here, right? If you drive up and down 91, it's incredible. My mom always says, why are you counting hawks on 91 and not watching the road? But I can go down 91 between here and Springfield and see 30 hawks. They're all over the place, you know? So they're really, really common in our area.
when you see them, they're usually flying way up in the air, and what they're doing is they are looking for prey, because they can see a mile down, right? And so then when they find something, they kind of do this slow, circular, like, swooping down instead of a falcon that's going to dive and shock something, right? She kind of slowly circles down and gets her prey, is what she does. So her eyesight is incredible, and also I think her focus to the moment is incredible without being, you know, without having to think in a bunch of directions. They function a little differently. You'll see the owls kind of check out when you put them on the glove, and the hawk is paying attention to everything. All of you, all the details, you know, she's pretty much like constantly watching. So, any questions before I go on to the next part? I'm going to keep her out for a minute, but any questions about Homer? You've got good questions, yes. Have I personally seen? It's mostly in pictures. It would be neat to look up the different red tail colors. I don't know. I think that would be awesome. But I don't know. I just know that they vary, and you never know if it's going to be more orangey or more red or more rust colored. It kind of depends. So I was there actually when we noticed the first little red of her tail this year. I was so excited because it was, like, before that we had no idea how old she was. We just knew that she was a juvenile.
Make another announcement.
Yeah. Thank
you. Could she fly with that wing?
Yeah.
No, she can hop around like kind of like in the enclosure. She could never have sustained flight with a wing like that. And it can't be fixed after it's been pinned once. It's kind of incredible that we can do that in the first place, if you think about it. So it can't really be, you can't really fix it. But it was such a, when we first got her, it took a few of us sitting and staring at her saying, what, you know, miss me? I'm wearing red shoes today.
I'll get a shot.
He'll get me at some point.
I
completely forgot what I was talking
ladies
about.
Ladies and gentlemen, now that I have your attention again, I just want to tell everyone that Rick Krolik and his Alexo team have prepared lunch, and so lunch is now available for all of our volunteers and anyone else that's hanging out. Feel free to come up and get some lunch. Thank you.
11:30. Do you have another question? No? Okay. So, any other questions about this girl? Okay, so really quickly, because I think it might be relevant.
I think we have a question.
Here,
sorry.
It's okay. What?
Oh, if Homer were able to fly, although not perfectly, would he be already accustomed to just coming back to get his daily rations from you instead of hunting for prey?
If she was able to fly well, if she had her ability to fly back, then she would, can I answer? Then yes, she would be able to go back to her normal ways of hunting. It's just that she can't fly in that sort of way. For hawks, it's really that kind of, you know, looking from way up above and circling down, and she can't do that kind of flight anymore, you know.
Yeah.
So, this is what it is.
Smart bird.
She is, yeah, and she, you know, we hope she'll stay, you know, doing well at these presentations and such, because she can meet a lot of kids and people throughout her life, be a great ambassador. Any more questions about her? So I just wanted to briefly say, so if you ever find a hurt bird, right? I think a lot of people just don't know what to do if you find a hurt bird of prey, you know? And so I think there's some fear that if you find a bird and you call the proper authorities that they will kill the bird. And I have to tell you, I'm a lover of birds. If that were the case, I would never tell you to call the authorities. It's not what happens. If they put the bird down, there's a really good reason for it. The bird's really, really sick or really hurt. So what you do is if you find a hurt bird, you can call anything. I mean, I would say the local police usually know what to do around that kind of thing, you know? I mean, but you can also call directly to wildlife rehab. You can look up online, I mean, this is what people do when they have a problem, wildlife rehabbers near me. Near us is a lovely man named Fred Homer. Right? And he will tell you, I have to warn you, he'll say things like, well, can you grab the owl? You know, and so for that's where I've come into play a lot in the last year or so, because he's like, just grab the owl, what's the problem, right? Some people are nervous to do that, right? But you call him and see if he can help. There's fish and wildlife that might be able to help you, right? You can call the Southern Vermont Natural History Museum, where we're from, speak with Michael Cluck, and these people post it on like the Brattleboro page all the time, which usually summons me. So. There's lots of ways to help, you know? So what happens is the bird will go to wildlife rehab, and then from there we'll go to a vet to be looked at and healed, you know? So they'll do whatever they can. And then from there it's determined if the bird can be released, which many of them can. Sometimes they can't, and then they come to programs like this and they kind of become ambassadors. So certainly step in and help if you see an injured bird. bird. They're easier to catch than you think. I'm going to be working this year to kind of train a group of volunteers to be wild bird of prey catchers for Fred Homer. If anybody is interested, feel free to get in touch. I would be happy to help. It's not very hard to grab a hurt bird. You think it is, right? Remember looking at Willow there. She weighs a pound and a half, that barred owl. This one weighs about 3 pounds, maybe 3.5 pounds, because she's starting to feel a little heavy. But that's about as heavy as they are. And they're going to want to take the wings and not let them. See how this is nice and tucked in? If she's like, I'm a wildbird. If she were to open up her wings right now, and I didn't have her on Jess's, I would quickly lose control of the situation. Her wingspan is enormous. It's 3 to 4 feet. Right, so she seems all contained right now. So bring a towel, because then what you can do is you can come up around and wrap the wings in. Just putting it out there. You all look sturdy enough to go grab an owl. I think the hawks are a little scarier.
You have to cover their eyes.
That helps later. That's what the second reason for the towel is. If you can cover their eyes after, that just helps them to be able to relax. Yep. So they kind of check out, like it's like a night, you know, nighttime. So that's what they do when you do that. In fact, the eagles at the museum, when we go to do health checks on them, we use the hoods, the falconry hoods. And it's wild, actually. Usually it takes 3 people, because one person puts the hood on the eagle and somebody else has to catch the sleeping eagle. They go to sleep like that. Sleeping eagle on somebody's lap for the health check. But that's what hoodwinked means. That's where that comes from. It's an old falconry term, right? You put like the hood on the bird goes to sleep immediately. I wish that there was a way to do that with humans that was as humane as that, actually. Because all you do, you're blocking out their vision. They just can't see, so they're like, it must be bedtime, good night right now. Right? Like, that would be wonderful if there was something equivalent for people. Unfortunately, there is not quite yet. But yeah. But anyways, so that's how to grab a bird if you need to.
Thank you. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Welcome back, riders. Thank you. Thank you, Colin. I just want to point out that right over here at this big tent, we still have raffle tickets for a variety of wonderful prizes. So as you're getting lunch, please make your way to the raffle ticket area, buy some raffle tickets, support the program. Also, the silent auction is still going on. So as you're settling in, please be sure to continue to support the program by patronizing the raffle and silent auction area. Thank you very much.
Older car, No, once in a while.
Oh, sure.
What we do is we take the profession, we give our information for more tax opportunities, wildlife, birds, all very mindful activities. We're teaching skills that really can benefit basically anybody. This population is especially important.
I'm going to do that, but
what?
I would like you to stand up, please. If you are a USB champion, please stand up so we can give you a round of applause and recognize. Champions and our third highest fundraising fundraiser for the program is Rex Sheldon. Rex, if you could come up here, please. I'd like to give you two tickets to see the New England Patriots beat the Miami Dolphins. Way to go, Rex. Rex raised $1,500. Way to go. Terry Emund is our second highest fundraiser. Where's Terry?
Terry! Everybody, Terry!
Terry!
I'm not sure where she is, but Terry, congratulations, Terry, for your hard work. She's greeting and saying goodbye to her friends. Terry is being recognized. She won the cornhole game, so she's going to be playing cornhole in her yard later today. We can all go over there and have some fun. Lastly, but also firstly, Colin Young is our top fundraiser, and he raised more than $2,500 for the program. Over the course of 10 years, Colin has done a lot for the Uniformed Services Program, as you all know, and it is really my pleasure to honor you, Colin, with the gift certificate to Madonna Harley Davidson. Thank you for everything you do.
Bring it to Michael and hand him the card.
Okay, folks, here we go. We're going to read all the raffle ticket. Now, the teleprompter is telling me to remind everyone not to throw your tickets out before we read all the numbers, which I think is a good practice to hold on to your tickets. All right, so the first one, the first prize, the first fabulous prize that we are reading off the ticket for is a hydro flask. This is a hot and cold hydro flask. It fits single serve coffee brew stations. The color is black. It's been generously donated by Esalon Coffee. And if you're ready for the number, here it comes. The number is 9882177. So that's ending in 177. We'll read the whole thing again. 9882177. Someone's coming.
What's the next one?
All right, very good.
Keep them coming. I'll take it.
Somebody checking this? Oh, I'm going to pass it over this
way. Kind of rainy day.
I'll pick a ticket to my
Okay, this is my personal favorite. Here we have some high-powered binoculars from Vortex Optics. These are 10 by 42. My personal favorite size. Also, Vortex Optics made a generous donation of 12 sets of binoculars so that Dave and I can take people out looking for wildlife and exercising some mindfulness skills. So this company has been very generous with us, and now they've donated this excellent prize.
Thank you.
And the number is 988. Noticing a pattern. 1832. Ending in 832. Do we have a winner?
Take
the
show it.
There he
you.
Is.
Get ready. I'll take your car.
Good. I'll tell you the
Yeah, all right. Swish them around and pick one.
Checking.
And bring it to my. Just take a look.
Okay, here we go. Next up, a Harley Davidson t-shirt. This is a Harley Davidson women's long sleeve shirt. Orange and black. This is what most Harley shirts are. This is a 2XL. It's been generously donated by the Nadnock Harley Davidson. And the number is 988-1258. Do we have a winner? Hey! Alright. Come on to claim your prize.
Yep, grab it because you want to check it against their ticket, but let her keep her ticket.
Rob, how's this going?
It's going great.
Okay.
There you go.
Can you remind people not to throw away their tickets?
Get pumped. Thank
nice
you, sir.
Nice job, everyone.
My
yes.
Remind people not to throw away their tickets.
Okay.
This is a friendly and gentle reminder not to throw your tickets away before I read all the numbers. Everybody still have their tickets?
Yeah.
We're going to get fired up. Thank you. Okay, here we have some Red Sox framed art. This is a Louis Tian framed photo, generously donated by Peter Deo. Look at that. And the number is 988-1961. Here's your Pateo. Come up and play your prize.
So grab the ticket from Michael. You're going to compare it to his ticket and let us know if we're all good.
Should I not say it?
Alright. The ticket, hold up. You're going to bring the ticket, and just to Michael, you hold on to the gift.
Now here's a gift that everybody can use. Generously donated by Village Pizza of Brattleboro, and it is a gift certificate for one large cheese family-sized pizza. Here we go. The number is 988-0469. Who got the pizza? Hey, all right. Come up and claim your prize.
It's me.
I don't know. All right. So there you go. Grab a ticket. Bring it to Mike. You are golden.
Oops. I got it. Hiding glove.
Our next prize, ladies and gentlemen, generously donated by Viking Cycles. Nice pair of riding gloves, Viking Cycle Panache Riding Textile Motorcycle Men's Extra Large Gloves. You're really going to want to get into these gloves.
And the number is...
I told them I would do something like this if they gave me the mic. What do you want from me?
The number is 988-0131. That's 988-0131.
All back here.
In the back.
In the back. In the back.
Woo!
Come on, try the gloves on.
All right.
OJ joke in there somewhere. Probably inappropriate.
It's a little dated. The dream team we got working for us here.
Is it a certain fire department?
Brattleboro Fire Department.
Thank you.
something.